Well, the topic is, why do Christians worship on Sunday? And it's a big topic, and I know that it's a big question as people look at Adventism, and there's a lot of misinformation about why Christians worship on Sunday. And so I thought I would give a general introduction and then several points that we can follow. And the information, the nice thing about video and audio and internet is that you can listen more than once and can catch up. And I'll also put the notes online so that you can pick up the notes. So what you miss, you can get. Well, exactly what day or date is the Sabbath? Because there's been a lot of talk that, you know, there has been a 7-day week from the beginning of creation, and the Sabbath day has always been known. But when you look at the history of our present calendar, you'll find that our days and our weeks and months and years have undergone many changes. We can't think that what is Sunday, February 20th, 2011, for instance, is really a Sunday, the same first day of the week that has remained constant since the time of God's creation of the world. Because here's an example. In 1582, Gregory the 13th found a miscalculation in the calendar, and he decreed to drop October 5 through 14 and three leap years in every century. So he just decided, boom, we're losing days. And he didn't just take a 7-day period so they could pick back up on a Monday or something like that. And then later in England, 11 days, September 3rd through 13th, were dropped in 1752, in addition to other changes. So, I mean, the calendar's been messed with, and not just dates, but days have been dropped and added. And so you can't be guaranteed that, say, the Tuesday or the second day of the week is the same number or day that went back to creation. Did Christian worship on Sunday come from paganism? Another issue that comes up often. And the answer is no, it did not come from paganism. Sunday was not a day of rest or a day of worship among pagans, and neither was it a weekly holiday. That is absolutely misinformation. In the early 20th century, D.M. Canright contacted highly qualified historians and professionals, including F.N. Price of the British Museum, Department of Greek and Roman Antiquities, R. Rathburn, Smithsonian Institute, and George F. Moore from Harvard University, professor of ancient Roman and Greek history. These are professionals who knew their subjects well. And their responses can be summarized as follows. They were asked questions about Sunday and pagan worship and that kind of thing. And their response was, the pagan Greeks and Romans did not have a regular weekday of rest or a regular festival on a Sunday or a regular feast day on Sunday. It's not history. That is not true. They did not have a regular weekday of rest. Neither was there any special day for people to go to the temples to pray. I know as Adventists, we had the idea that, well, they just went to temple to their false worship on Sunday. That is absolutely not true. It's completely historically inaccurate. For the Greeks and the Romans, the month was the unit of time, not the week. And so the month was divided into three different sections. Like the end of the month would be the 13th to the 15th, something like that. And it would be called the Ides, like the Ides of March. You've heard of that. And so there were three divisions of the month. And these subdivisions had absolutely no religious significance. They were secular. Every 8 days, the Romans had market days. And that's part, they would make mark some time that way. But it was an 8-day week. Not a 7-day week. So the idea that the pagan day of the sun was able to, you know, just transferred to Sunday is just not true. It's historically inaccurate. They had no religious significance on these eight-day sections of time. It was just a market day. The introduction of a seven-day week into the Roman calendar came from Egypt and was no earlier than the second century AD. The planetary week, in which the days were named from their, like Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, named after planets, that was put into place by the astronomers and not by anybody who was a religious, any relation to religion. The sun god was not worshipped on Sunday, and the moon god was not worshipped on Monday, etc. These names don't have any religious significance to the ancients in terms of worship. The seven-day period of dividing the month appears in the Roman calendar after 391 A.D., and in Roman law in a constitution of Constantine in 321. So we understand the history of the week cannot be determined. It was not, there was no pagan regular weekly day of worship. Is that clear? Everybody understand that? So who changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday? Was it the Emperor Constantine, as is often suggested? Did he do that in 325 AD? Or was it the Roman Catholic Church that changed the day? This historical inaccuracy that the Pope changed the day, or the Roman Catholic Church changed the day, has been propagated by the Seventh-day Baptists for over 300 years, and by the Seventh-day Adventists since the latter part of the 19th century. Often the question is asked, well, isn't it to worship on Sunday paying homage to the Roman Catholic Church? And because Constantine changed the day of worship. It's claimed that Constantine's edict of March 7, 321, changed the day of Christian worship from Saturday to Sunday. Well, he didn't change the day. Christians, the records show, have always worshiped on the first day. He simply acknowledged it and legalized the first day. Christians had been persecuted to death, literally, their properties confiscated, their bishops killed, the leaders of the church, and pastors arrested and jailed. Many were martyred. Scriptures were, the Roman emperors were attempting to eradicate the scriptures. And so when Constantine was converted and the Roman Empire, he was sympathetic now to Christianity. He legalized Christianity again, rebuilt churches, and legalized the Christian day of worship. So careful examination of the historical early church documents also reveal that the church worshipped on the first day of the week, going way back to before the death of the Apostle John. Let's look. I just want to share with you some of the earliest historical evidence that we have. Let me look at the New Testament record first. From the resurrection of Christ, Christians have always worshipped on the first day of the week and not on the Sabbath. I know this is hard for many people who have been lifelong Sabbath keepers to hear, but just listen and keep an open mind for a minute, because truth has nothing to fear from investigation. Sunday is not a Christian Sabbath. This is important to understand that Christians do not believe, many Christians do not believe that Sunday is a Christian Sabbath. Now, some Roman Catholics, they teach that it is. Lutherans do. Many of the Reformed faith, they do. But the Bible doesn't teach Sunday as a Sabbath day. It would be should be thought of more as, if you want to compare it to anything, one of the biblical festivals. It's a day of celebration, rather. Now, the seven post-resurrection appearances of Christ are very telling. Jesus, of these appearances after his resurrection, we know that of the days he appeared to his disciples, we know the day that he appeared, we know five of those instances. The other two of the seven, we don't know what day it was that he met with them. But in each instance, he met always on a Sunday. Now, our Lord, Jesus Christ, would know that we might get confused. He would know that if he wanted to honor the Sabbath day after his resurrection, what would you expect him to do? He would always appear to his disciples on the Sabbath day. I mean, that would make complete sense to me. But rather, the evidence shows that these occurrences were always on the first day of the week. For instance, Mary, on the morning of the resurrection, Jesus, of course, met, it was the resurrection day, the Sunday. Two disciples going to the Emmaus. Again, he met with them on the first day, on Sunday. When he met with Simon Peter, it was on a Sunday. And the 11 disciples, when he met with them, it was on a Sunday. And when he met a week later with the 11 disciples, it was on a Sunday. Now, another point, this would be my second point. The first point was when Jesus met with the disciples was always on a Sunday. The second point is that the New Testament church was born on a Sunday. Jesus always met with his disciples when we have the record of the day on a Sunday. The Lord chose a Sunday to cause the church to come into existence. Now, that day was the Feast of Pentecost. The Feast of Pentecost was commanded to always be on the first day of the week. Always it was to be celebrated on a Sunday, as well as the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which is the day that our Lord rose from the dead, correct? And so that was commanded always to be on a Sunday, never to be on a Sabbath. The law of Moses said it was always to be on a Sunday, the Feast of Unleavened Bread and the Feast of Pentecost. If you want to win $1,000, you can now answer the argument where they say, you show me one passage in the Bible that shows that Christians should worship on Sunday or that Sunday is a Sabbath. You've just won $1,000, folks. Ding, 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 ding. Because the scripture says that those 2 days are Sundays and they're to be kept as Sabbaths. So there you go. I'm going to cash in on that one of these days. I just haven't had time, okay? So if the Lord wanted to honor the Sabbath as the birthday of the church would have been born on a Sabbath day. Rather, he chose the first day of the week. The third point is whenever a day of the week is mentioned in connection with the appearances of our risen Lord, it is always the first day of the week. So Jesus startled them when he appeared, and this is, you know, on their worship day. He received worship from Thomas on the first day of the week. Jesus took the bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and established the Lord's Supper, communion, on Sunday, not on the Sabbath day. Their eyes were opened, and they saw him. Jesus said, "Peace to you," on Sunday. On Sunday evening, the Lord breathed out the Holy Spirit upon his disciples, and on Sunday evening, he gave his disciples the ecclesiastical authority to proclaim forgiveness to those who believed in him through the gospel. Now, pardon me for not giving all the scriptural references, but as I say, you'll be able to get them in notes. I just want you to hear the big ideas and write down the major points. Why did the disciples meet on Sunday? It was because it now had special, symbolic, antitypical, if you will, significance for them. Jesus chose to reveal himself to them only on Sunday, when we know what day it is, because that must hold special divine significance. Jesus could have chosen to meet with his disciples on the Sabbath. And that, of course, would have clearly set a new covenant precedent. If we always saw him meeting on a Sabbath, then we would clearly always be meeting on a Sabbath. He did not choose to do this because the Sabbath was a sign of now a fulfilled covenant, as Hebrews 8, verse 13 said. Well, the fourth point is this. The first church council did not include the Sabbath as an essential doctrine or practice for the early church. In Acts chapter 15, this is a very important point too. In Acts 15, the council convened to determine what Gentile Christians must observe. A controversy had arisen within the church as to what Jewish laws. There were Christians who were still holding on to Jewish remnants of Judaism because they're in this transition period, understandably. And so what should be practiced by the Gentiles. And so as the council came to decisions, James was leading the church at that point. Sabbath keeping in the discussion was conspicuously absent. Now you say, well, that might be an argument from silence. Well, no, don't go there yet, because Peter exhorted the leadership of the church not to place upon, James did rather, the Gentiles under the law, Acts 15. I'll quote to you, it says, "Now therefore, why do you put God to the test by placing upon the neck of the disciples a yoke which neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear?" He's talking about the law and the entire law. But we believe that we are saved through grace of the Lord Jesus the same way they are also. See, he even distinguishes the Gentiles who don't do the law and Jews who have been saved who are doing the law. He says they're doing two different things, but he says we're saved the same way. Obviously, if the Gentiles are saved not under the burden of the law, you don't have to keep the Sabbath commandment to be saved. The final judgment of the Jerusalem Council, though, contained no reference to Sabbath keeping. In contrast, circumcision was discussed and deemed unnecessary. As you look at Acts 15, the whole chapter I want to refer you to. So if Sabbath keeping were an essential part of the new covenant relationship with God, it would have been mentioned in the discussion and it would have been placed upon the Gentiles. Sabbath keeping was not even discussed because it's not a requirement for the New Covenant believers. Acts 15, 28, just here's another section of it. "For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these essentials, that you abstain from things sacrificed to idols and from blood and from things strangled and from fornication. If you keep yourself free from such things, you will do well, farewell." So these were what the Holy Spirit, it seemed good to us and to the Holy Spirit not to put any other thing upon you, Gentiles. So the Holy Spirit deemed it unnecessary to even mention the Sabbath day. Obviously, he didn't think the Sabbath keeping was an essential thing anymore. You see, when the New Testament lists sins, in the New Testament, this would be the fifth point. Sabbath keeping is conspicuously absent. Now, the New Testament repeats, it gives moral teachings and moral commandments throughout. In fact, you can reconstruct all 9 of the 10 commandments in the New Testament because the New Testament is not a book that is immoral. It's a book that teaches right living, and we live in order to please God. In Mark 7, 21 through 22, 13 sins are listed. But Jesus did not mention Sabbath breaking in any of them. And we want to suggest that if Sabbath keeping is the seal of God and Sunday keeping is the mark of the beast, wouldn't Jesus know that? And it's insulting to even ask the question, frankly, insulting to our Lord. But wouldn't he have known to at least list that in the categories of sin or somewhere in his teachings? In Romans 1, verses 29 through 32, 20 sins are listed. And not one of them is Sabbath breaking. In Galatians 5, 19 through 21, a list of 15 sins are given. And you know what I would say? Not one of them lists Sabbath breaking. In 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 4, there's a list of 18 sins, but not once is a Sabbath mentioned. Breaking the Sabbath is not mentioned. Now, the sixth point is this. Why is it that nowhere in the New Testament is it taught that the fourth commandment must be observed? Christians don't keep the Ten Commandments of Moses. We don't keep the Ten Commandment law of Moses. This is not to say that Christians are free to steal and murder and commit adultery, etc. For one thing, we wouldn't want to because we've been given a new heart and a new nature, and we want to live and please the Lord. Christians are under a new law, better law, we're told, and a better covenant, and nowhere in the New Testament is a failure to keep the Sabbath day condemned as a sin. The fourth commandment itself is not repeated even once in the New Testament. Sabbath breaking is so important for a disciple of Christ. Why is it not mentioned in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount or in any of his messages? Why didn't Jesus command Sabbath keeping? If the Savior loves us so much and he wants us to be saved, why didn't he mention what seems to be the most important thing in the last days, which would be honoring the Sabbath day because it's the seal of God? Why wouldn't he have mentioned this?
Excuse me, Mark. Didn't Jesus say that Sabbath is made for man?
Yes, but he's not commanding the Sabbath day.
No.
And I'm just going to have to move on because I have to cover the territory, and we can talk after. I don't mean to be rude. It's not my heart at all. Why didn't any of the apostles command Sabbath keeping? Why didn't the Jerusalem Council command Sabbath keeping or to commend Sabbath or condemn it? And I think the answer to that is that it was taken for granted that, well, some answer that the reason why Jesus didn't command it, and this common thing that comes up, is that it was taken for granted that, you know, look, we'd be keeping the Sabbath because we've always kept the Sabbath. And so that's why they didn't mention it. But why were all the other nine commands in the New Testament reiterated, but not the Sabbath? And it wouldn't be customary for Gentiles to worship on any day, right? We've already seen this. They didn't even have a holy day. The Gentiles had to be instructed that circumcision was not important. Wouldn't they have to be instructed that the Sabbath was important if it was for the New Testament observance? It wasn't mentioned because it wasn't to be taught to them. Why would something that important be ignored? Now, the seventh point is this. Sabbath keepers argue that it is the example of Jesus that gives us the reason for keeping the Sabbath. He kept the Sabbath, so I must keep the Sabbath because Jesus is my example. Well, this kind of reasoning is flawed because it only chooses Jesus' Sabbath keeping and rejects the rest of what Jesus did. Rejects the rest of his Jewish lifestyle. Jesus also kept kosher laws, and I don't mean he just didn't eat pork and shellfish. Okay? He kept all 613 of the laws. He kept the Passover, Sukkot, Hanukkah, and the other celebrations yearly and monthly, and the new moons. He worshiped in the temple, offering sacrifices. Are we to follow everything he did? Galatians 4, verses 4 through 5 says that Jesus lived under the law to redeem us from the law. And when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, that he might redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Jesus was accused of Sabbath breaking. Why, if he wanted to be our example in Sabbath keeping, wouldn't he have been a little more careful in what he was doing on the Sabbath? Instead, he clearly admitted to breaking the Sabbath. Jesus did break the Sabbath. Therefore, some of the Pharisees were saying, "This man is not from God because he does not keep the Sabbath," John 9:15. If Jesus didn't want us to understand that he broke the Sabbath, wouldn't he have said, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that." Wouldn't he have said, "No, you've got the wrong idea"? Instead, he let them think he was breaking the Sabbath. He did not speak against these accusations because Jesus had the right and authority to break the Sabbath because he is Lord of the Sabbath. The Sabbath does not bind him. Think about this. If it does not bind the Lord, are we not in Christ? Why would it be any more binding on us? He also admitted that his disciples broke the Sabbath, and he defended them. In Mark chapter 12, 1 through 14, Jesus clearly said that his disciples were like priests who may work in the temple every Sabbath and be innocent of breaking the Sabbath. And when Jesus said that he was Lord of the Sabbath, he was declaring that he was above the Sabbath. He could do what he wished on the Sabbath, and therefore his disciples could do whatever they wished because they were his disciples. One of the issues that needs to be honestly faced is the fact that Jesus never commanded anyone to ever keep the Sabbath, and neither did his apostles. Not once in the New Testament are we told to keep the Sabbath. Those commands to the church are conspicuously absent. The eighth point is this. Every mention of the Sabbath in the book of Acts, without a single exception, is in connection with Jewish worship on that day and not with Christian celebration. Paul's evangelistic strategy was always to go to the Jew first and then to the Greek. And the Sabbath was a day when he knew that he would find the most Jews in the best place. His strategy was to use the best use of his time. They had been set up by the Old Testament scriptures to be ready to receive the Messiah. And so he would find Jews in the synagogues or by the riverside. If they didn't have a large enough group to meet together, then they would meet by a place like a riverside or something. So he would go where he could find them first. The ninth point is this. Early Christian documents outside of the New Testament testify that the Christian church worshiped on Sunday from the end of the first century. Now, these are not Catholic people. These are the disciples of the disciples. Some of them wrote while their mentors were still alive. For instance, Pliny, in his letter of 107 AD, he was the governor of Bithynia, by the way. This is, let me jump. He is a pagan observing Christians. And this is what he said in his letter to Trajan, the emperor. He says concerning the Christians, they were wont to meet together on a stated day. See, that's a little different. Jews and Christians had a stated day. Before it was light, and they sing among themselves alternately a hymn to Christ as God. And when these things were performed, it was their custom to separate and then to come together and again to have a meal which they ate in common without any disorder. We know that the early church broke bread. He says these Christians would break bread. We know in Acts 20, verse 7, upon the first day of the week, the disciples came together to break bread. They were known to break bread on a certain day. In 107, the epistle of Ignatius to the Magnesians said this, and I'm not going to read you the whole paragraphs because of time. But it says, he writes, we no longer observe the Sabbath, but living in the observance of the Lord's day. He continues, let us therefore no longer keep the Sabbath after the Jewish manner and rejoice in days of idleness. He continues, let every friend of Christ keep the Lord's day as a festival of the resurrection day and the queen and chief of all the days of the week. The Epistle of Barnabas in 120 AD. And these are historical documents that all Christians look to as, okay, we can reconstruct New Testament life in the early church. We understand it. And these are considered, they're valid, okay? We're not talking about some nuts writing. These are the early church fathers. Barnabas in 120 writes, incense is a vain abomination unto me, and your new moons and Sabbaths I cannot endure. He has therefore abolished these things. The epistle of Barnabas, written at 100 AD, we think the Apostle John received the revelation in 90 AD. He may have been alive at 100 AD. And of course, the Apostle John was revered. Okay, he's the Lord's best friend. He won't die. You know, the Lord says you're going to live and not be martyred. This is what Barnabas says. He says, wherefore also we keep the eighth day with joyfulness, the day also on which Jesus rose again from the dead. Justin Martyr in 140 AD wrote, and he was a second century Christian apologist. Justin's apology was written in Rome about the year 140. only 44 years after the death of the Apostle John, or rather, after only 44 years after the revelation of at Patmos. And at this early date of 140, the only major difference among Christians was concerning the millennium. Can you believe it? That's all Christians disagreed on. And at that time, they had no disagreement in keeping Sunday, as you will see. Justin says that the day on which all Christians worshiped was Sunday. In chapter 67 of his first apology, entitled Weekly Worship of the Christians, writing to the pagan emperor Justin, he states, "We bless the Maker of all through his Son, Jesus Christ, and through the Holy Ghost, and on the day called Sunday, all who live in the cities or in the country gather together to one place, and the memoirs of the apostles or the writings of the prophets are read as long as time permits." Continues, "But Sunday is the day on which we all hold our common assembly. I can quote you Irenaeus, Dionysius, I can quote you Clement of Alexandria, all within 100 years of the book of Revelation, Tertullian of Africa. They continue, "We solemnize the day after Saturday in contradistinction of those who call this their Sabbath. We make Sunday a day of festivity." So this is the testimony of the early church, which cannot be discounted. And I will put that all online, and you can see those already. It's listed in some of the books we have on exadventist.org. Some Sabbatarians argue that the Council of Laodicea, the Roman Catholic Church, changed the Sabbath from the seventh day to the first day. And this is just not true either. The Sabbath was not changed at that council. What did take place was that the council was an anti-Semitic move to make it illegal for a Christian to worship on Saturday, but one needs to note that thousands of Christians were already worshiping on Sunday, the first day of the week. The apostolic constitutions of church life in 380 AD says, "On the day of the resurrection of the Lord, that is the Lord's day, assemble yourselves together without fail." The tenth point is this. The Sabbath was not mentioned or commanded in the book of Genesis or during the time period of the book of Genesis. It's very important now. No one prior to the Exodus was commanded to remember the Sabbath. The Sabbath is not mentioned in the book of Genesis. If God instituted the Sabbath before the fall of man, it seems strange that the fact is not recorded in Genesis that Adam was not told to observe it. Nowhere in the book of Genesis do we read of Adam or any of his descendants, Noah, Abraham, or any of the Jewish patriarchs concerning the Sabbath. Adam was not commanded to observe the Sabbath. The first mention of 7 days is in the 7 days of creation, and we'll come to that back to that in a second. I want to address this when we talk about the commandment, remember the Sabbath. But the second mention of the sevenfold division of the days is found in Genesis 7, verses 4 and verse 10, when the 7 days of grace were granted before the flood came. "For after 7 more days, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will blot out from the face of the land every living thing that I have made." And then it says, "When it came about after the 7 days, that the water of the flood came upon the earth." The third time the seventh day is mentioned is in Genesis 8, verses 8 through 12, and that is the 7 day period after the flood, that when Noah sent out the dove to see if the flood waters had abated. And so, although there are these references to 7 day periods of time, there is no mention, you know, when it mentions 7 day periods of time, there's no mention of the Sabbath in the book of Genesis. Melchizedek, the king priest of Salem, is mentioned in the book of Genesis and in the New Testament in the book of Hebrews, and yet there's no mention of the Sabbath in connection with Melchizedek. The book of Job is the oldest book in the Bible, and Job, near the time of the patriarch Abraham, lives, and there is no mention of the Sabbath in the book of Job. And we know that Job was a godly man. That's in chapter 1, verse 1. He prayed for his children, offered sacrifices to the Lord on their behalf. God held him up as a righteous man. The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? For there is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, fearing God, turning away from evil." When Job defended his integrity, he never, ever mentioned, "And I've kept the Sabbath." The scriptures are very clear that the Sabbath of the fourth commandment was not given before Moses. The Ten Commandments was not made with the fathers. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 2 and 3 says, "The Lord our God made a covenant with us at Horeb. The Lord did not make this covenant with our fathers, but with us, with those of us alive here today." In the book of Genesis and during the time period covered in the book of Genesis, there's the creation, the fall of man, the pre-flood period, the post-flood period through the patriarchs to the death of Joseph, and there is absolutely no mention or reference, inferred or otherwise, that the Sabbath day was known, kept, or observed in any way. That's very significant. The 11th point. The first mention of the Sabbath is during the time of Moses and the deliverance of Israel from Egyptian slavery. The first mention we read of Sabbath in the Bible is in Exodus chapter 16, verses 22 through 23, and that's in connection with the gathering of the manna. The Lord says in verse 23, "This is what the Lord means. Tomorrow is a Sabbath observance, a holy day to the Lord." They were clueless. The Lord had to say, "This is what I mean. Tomorrow is a Sabbath day to you." He didn't say the Sabbath like they knew what it was. Moses had to explain why twice as much bread had to be taken up on this day. They didn't clue in. He explained to them why. This highlights the fact that they were not keeping a Sabbath day prior to the giving of manna. Sabbath was an entirely new concept that had to be taught to them. A few weeks later, the old covenant was given on Mount Sinai. And the Lord said in Exodus 20, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your sons or your daughters, your male or your female servants or your cattle or your sojourner who stays with you." They were to remember the Sabbath day. What would they remember? They were to remember the first mention of the Sabbath when God sent the manna and Moses explained that there would be a Sabbath rest on the seventh day. He was reminded, "Now remember the Sabbath day that I told you about when we started collecting the manna." The Sabbath day they were to remember was not the seventh day on which God rested after creation, but the Sabbath that God had appointed as the Sabbath day at the time of the giving of the manna. In Nehemiah chapter 9, we're told, "You came down on Mount Sinai. You spoke to them from heaven. You gave them regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commandments that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands, decrees, and laws for your servant Moses." They didn't have the Sabbath commandment before Mount Sinai. It was made known to them then. The Sabbath was given as a part of the old covenant. Nehemiah 9 indicates that the Sabbath was not given to be kept by anyone until it was given to Israel in the wilderness. God tied in Exodus 20 the new concept of Sabbath to his rest after creation. God worked 6 days and then rested on the seventh day from the work of creation. It was a completed work, so God didn't resume working on the eighth day. Genesis 2, verses 2 and 3 says this. God rested because his work was finished. God rested because his work was not only finished, but it was good. But when God's perfect work was marred by sin, by the fall of man, his rest was broken. And as soon as man fell, it was necessary for God to resume his work. This time not to accomplish creation, but to accomplish the salvation of man. And so Jesus, explaining his mission, said in John 6, but he answered them, my Father is working until now, and I myself am working. In Genesis 2, verses 2 through 3, we are simply told that God rested from his work of creating on the seventh day. The day is not called a Sabbath day. We are told that God blessed and sanctified it. That is, set it apart as a rest day. We are not told the length of the seventh day of creation. Well, there are several more points that I would like to cover. We're out of time. I would say they're very important points. You see that there is so much evidence. It's not a simple matter of, well, look at the fourth commandment, you dummy. Don't you see that the seventh day is the Sabbath? It's a much more complex issue, and yet very simple when you see. And so my prayer is that you'll just continue to do investigation, because the truth has nothing to fear from investigation. So read the information. Go to internet sites. If you can't talk to somebody, you don't want to be found at some meeting or something. The internet has opened up the world. And for this reason, many people are having their eyes opened, because there is now free access to information. On our website, we have many books that you may have never seen or read before. Some of them old, some of them new. And we've put them on PDF files. And so you can go into our PDF library and you begin to read some of the things I'm sharing with you, as well as the notes here that I'm sharing and much of it that I haven't been able to get to. And if you have questions, you can contact our site, exadventist.org. You can go to Former Adventist Fellowship. You can check their site out. You can go to Dale Retzliff's site, which is lifeassuranceministries.org. And there's so many sites now. I mean, it's everywhere. You can find the truth yourself. So don't just go with what you've always heard, because history has not been told you correctly, all right? You've been told that Constantine changed the day, etc. That is not true. You've been told that Sunday was a pagan day of worship. That's not true. They didn't have a day of worship. So there's some things to check out. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, that your word opens to us truth and freedom that we've never seen. And we also thank you, Lord, that as we worship and celebrate on Sunday, we do so in honor of your resurrection, just like the church did throughout the book of Acts, as the early church did. And they called it the Lord's Day. It is indeed your day, Lord, because you raised from the dead. It's not a Sabbath, not at all. The Sabbath was a shadow pointing toward you. We have the substance. We don't hang on to shadows. But Lord, we do want to remember every single week the wonderful fact of our salvation, completed, finished, freely given. We celebrate the assurance we have in you. Lord, we thank you that you have given to us truth. May we have courage to press on, to seek it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. 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 Amen.